Good morning. I do not own the rights to this music, but I'm excited to sing with you this morning because it's Sunday. It's 7 o'clock. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Get up, get up, get up. Good morning. How do you know that this ain't your day? How do you know that miracles ain't coming your way? How do you know? You got to get up to find out. Come on, because he's intentional. He's intentional about what he's going to do for you, but you got to wake up. You got to get up. You got to come on and bless the Lord with me. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Because he's intentional. He's never failing. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Hey, y'all. Good morning. All things are working for our good because he's intentional. Good morning. Come on. He's never failing. Come on. Good morning. Let's praise him. Hey, good morning, Ms. Ivana. Good morning, Ms. Brenda. Hey, Ms. Beverly. Good morning, Ms. Evelyn. Hey, good morning. All things never failing. Come on, y'all. Good morning. All things are working for our good. Hey, Ms. Arisa. Good morning, Jasmine. Good morning. Good morning. Wake up. Wake up. Wake up. Come on. Get up. All things are working for our good. Let's praise them, y'all. Good morning, Ms. Patricia. Who knows that all things are working for their good? Because he's intentional. Hey, Lynette, he's intentional. He's intentional, y'all. He's going to make sure you get your blessing. He's never failing. Hey, Miss Linda. Hey, Peaches. Good morning. Good morning, Miss Brenda. Hey, Mother Love. Hey, Miss Joyce. He's intentional, y'all. He's intentional. And he's never failing. Never failing, y'all. Somebody say, all things are working for my good. All things, she, hey, all things are working for our good. And he's never failing, Keita. He's never failing. All things are working for my good. Because he's intentional. Never failing. Somebody say, all things, all things, all things, all things are working for my good. Because God knows what we need. Good morning, Rakita. God knows what we need. Good morning, Sharon. He knows what we need, so all things are working for my good. I don't care what it looks like. I don't care what it feels like, Miss Sonia. Good morning. All things are working for my good. Because he's intentional, Stacey. He's intentional. All things. Come on, put your hands up. Say, oh, oh, hey, Tanya. Happy birthday, boo. Oh, oh, oh. It's working, it's working, it's working, it's working, it's working, it's working, it's working. Come on, I don't have to worry. It's working for me. Hey, Donna, good morning. It's working for me. I believe it. Come on, Lynette, good morning, good morning, good morning. You can smile again, y'all. Come on. You don't have to worry because it's working for me. You don't have to worry. You don't have to worry, Tiffany. You don't got to worry, Letty. You don't got to worry because it's working for you. Come on. Say, I don't have to worry. Come on. I don't have to worry because it's working for me. It's working for me. Hey. I don't have to worry because... it's working for me. It ain't working for you, but it's working for me. So it might not be working for you, but it's working for me. Come on. I know I can't see it right now, but I know it's working for me. It's coming. It's coming because he's intentional. He's intentional. Everything he does, when I say he's intentional, it's intentional. Come on. He's intentional about what he's doing in your life. He's intentional. Hey, Mr. Wanda, good morning. Good morning, good morning, good morning, good morning, good morning, good morning. You don't have to worry about a thing today because he's intentional. Everything that's happening in your life is because it's working for your good. All things work together for the good of those who believe. He's intentional. God bless us today. God bless us today. What do it mean to be intentional? God is deliberate about what he's doing in your life. He is calculated. He has calculated the situation. He knows exactly what you need. He's intentional. Intentional means that he's conscious of what you need. He understands what you need. Don't think he don't know. Everything you need on this earth, he knows. It's done on purpose. The thing that's happening to you is done on purpose. That's what intentional means. It's done on purpose. It's already planned out. It's predestined. Come on. Let somebody know it's predetermined. Everything that's happening to you, all good. It's happening to you. God is a God of good. He's a good God of perfect will. Everything is happening in your life because he's intentional. And he's never failing. You don't have to worry about a thing today. Say, I ain't worrying about nothing. Say, I will seek the Lord today. I'm not worried about nothing. The Lord, the Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God. All these things shall be added unto you. But before that, he said, don't worry about nothing. He'll feed the birds. He take care of the lilies of the valley. So why you worry? He's intentional about what's happening to you. So don't worry about a thing. I know we got some things that's going on. I know we got some stuff that's going on. But I'm telling you today, say, I don't have to worry because it's working for me. It's working for me. Hey, I believe it. Say, I don't have to worry because it's working for me. It's working for me. I don't know about you, but it's working for me. Come on, let's pray. God bless us today. God, shine your light on us. Holy Spirit, come down today. We need you like never before. Loose, heal, deliver, save, and set free. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, your strength and our redeemer. Let the people of God say amen, amen, and amen. Holy Spirit, have your way today like never before. Anoint us afresh. Anoint us afresh, God. We love you today. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you today. I love that God is deliberate about what he's doing in my life. He's deliberate about what he's doing in your life. He is deliberate. Do you know what that means? That he is already, it already is already in his mind. I'm excited because last week was amazing. We learned about a new year, a new heart, and a fresh wind. And I didn't get a chance to go on about the fresh wind, but I want to talk about that today. Sorry, I need my glasses. About a fresh wind. Before I start, I want to say to all you that had an opportunity to fast with us this week, glory to God. I hope that you enjoy Evangelist Latrice Ryan. She is amazing. I hope that you receive something. I hope that God blessed your heart with her words. I hope that she encouraged you to continue to push on. So I just thank y'all so much for always supporting. I thank y'all so much for always just listening to the voice of God. And when I receive something, I always make sure I give it to you. I don't keep everything that I receive to myself because I know that if it's working for me, it'll work for you. Amen. So I'm just so excited. I'm just so thankful. Even if you didn't get a chance to do the fast, go on to her page and just listen to her on Tuesdays at 7 a.m. She's on every Tuesday at 7 a.m. on Facebook Live. She's amazing. So last week I talked about repentance and having a new heart. But this week I want to talk about a fresh wind. Somebody say a fresh wind. A fresh wind. I'm going to read Psalm 51 verse 1 to 15, but I want to read it out of the Message version. Because the way it talks about it in the Message version is just like so amazing and I love it. You know, Psalm 51, you know, we always talk about Psalm 51, intent creating me a clean heart and renewing me a right spirit. But I want to read Psalm 51, 1 to 15 in the Message version. It says, generous in love, God give grace, huge in mercy, wipe out my bad record. Somebody say, wipe out my bad record. I know you know my record. I know you know what I did wrong. I know what you did in the past, what I did in the past. But David is asking God to wipe out his bad record. He's a murderer. He got Bathsheba's husband killed. He's a murderer. He said, wipe out my bad record. Scrub away my guilt. Soak out my sins in your laundry. Do you know now? I don't know if anybody's on here old enough to remember a washboard. Back in the day, they didn't have washers and dryers. They had washboards and the lines outside to dry the clothes. They would take a washboard and scrub out the dirt. They wouldn't just throw it in the laundry, in the washer. They would scrub it out. And David is saying, I'm taking this washboard and I want you to scrub out my guilt. Scrub it away. Some of us need a washboard. We don't need to keep throwing our sins in a washing machine. We need to take a washboard and ask God to scrub our sins away. That's what David is asking. He says, scrub away my guilt. Soak out my sins in your laundry. You know what that means, right? Soak out your sins in the laundry. You know when you get OxyClean, when you just can't get it out, and you just let it soak in. That's what David is asking, to soak out my sins in your laundry. He's making it so plain in the Message version. It says, I know how bad I've been. Come on, you know how bad you've been. You know how messed up you was. You know what you was doing in 2017, 18, 19, 20, 21. But let me tell y'all something. In 2022, we're getting our sins soaked away. What? It says, my sins are staring me down. You're the one I violated. Let me tell you something. David knew that he violated and he killed Bathsheba's husband, but he said, I know I killed her husband, but Nathan is reminding me, my friend Nathan is reminding me, but I want you to remove my guilt because I sinned against God. When you mess up, you're sinning against God. And that's what David said. I sinned against you, Lord. He said, I violated and you've seen it all, seen the full extent of my evil. You have all the facts before you. Whatever you decide about me is fair. I've been out of step with you for a long time, in the wrong sense before I was born. How many of y'all been out of step with God? Oh my God, don't put it on the chat. Don't put it on the chat. It says, what you're after is truth from the inside out. David said to God, what you're after is the truth from the inside out. What he's after is the truth. You can hide all you want, but he's after the truth. You gotta be honest with yourself. He already know. You gotta be honest with yourself. It says, enter me. Somebody say, enter me. Holy Spirit, enter me. Then conceive a new true life. That's what he's asking for. He created me a clean heart. He said, enter me. In order for him to create, he has to enter you. The Holy Spirit has to enter you. So you have to be saved. You can't just ask God to enter you and you don't believe in him. He goes on to say, soak me in your laundry and I'll come out clean. Scrub me and I'll have a snow white life. Tune me into foot tapping songs. Set these once broken bones to dancing. Don't look too close for blemishes. Oh my God, don't look at me too close. Don't get all the way up. Don't put your glasses on. Come on. Don't get all up on me. He said, don't look too close for blemishes. Give me a clean bill of health. What? I want a clean bill of health. David just killed somebody. And he's asking God for a clean bill of health. Like, wipe it all away. Now, if a murderer that's a king can ask for a clean bill of health, what about you? Come on. You can ask too. And you can receive it. You don't got to keep walking around with your sins. You don't got to keep reminding yourself of what you've done. Just ask for a clean bill of health. He says, God, make a fresh start in me. Shape a Genesis week from the chaos of my life. He said, take me back to the beginning. The chaos of my life, all the stuff I done. A Genesis week. He want to start from the beginning. He says, don't throw me out with the trash. Or fail to breathe holiness in me. Oh my gosh. He said, don't throw me out with the trash. Or fail to breathe. Come on with the Ruha breath of God. Don't fail to breathe holiness in me. He like, don't forget to breathe in me. I know I messed up. But send me a fresh wind. It goes on to say, bring me back from great exile. Put a fresh wind in my sails. What? He said, bring me back from great exile. I've been far away. I done messed up. I done left the camp. But put a fresh wind in my sails. Not C-E-L-L-S, but the sail, like Sailor, S-A-I-L-S, put a fresh wind in my sails. That means you in a boat with God. That means it's time for you to get to the next destination. But how are you going to get there? You need a fresh wind. You done messed up, and God is ready to give you a fresh wind. But you got to believe that he will. I'm going to tell you, I looked up what it means to have a fresh wind from a sailor standpoint. It says that a sailor, let me go back. I want to read what I wrote down. The Greek word for wind is pneuma. Write down this word. P-N-E-U-M-A. It's pneuma. That's the word for wind. That's the Greek word for wind. But spirit, it's a current of air. Wind is a current of air. Fresh wind is equal to the word regenerate, revive, reawaken, rekindle, resuscitate. To breathe new life into. It is the messenger. Wind is the messenger of divine intervention. And it is the vital breath of the universe. Wind often represents the fleeting and transient, the elusive and intangible. You can't touch wind. It's intangible. However, the Holy Spirit does the blowing of the fresh wind in the spiritual, which is the Ruha breath of God. Come on, somebody. But in the natural, for a sailor to get his to get to his destination, he needs a fresh wind. And you need a fresh pneuma. Somebody say, I need a fresh wind. You need a fresh wind today to get to your next destination. And together, the forces of drag from the water and the process from the wind against the sail itself push the craft forward. So the wind, when you're in the water as a sailor, it pushes the craft forward. It pushes the boat forward. It moves at an angle opposite the direction of the wind, called inward. So when the wind is blowing opposite direction of the wind, but the boat is going in the inward direction. The sailor follows the wind. Come on, somebody. The sailor follows the wind. Why don't you follow the wind of God? You doing everything you want to do. The sailor even have to follow the compass in the wind. But what are we doing? It says the sailor follows the wind in an upwind. That's U-P-W-I-N-D, an upwind, which means when you are going against the wind. It's an upwind, then it's a downwind, which is when you are going with the wind. Come on, some of y'all is in the upwind and some of y'all is in the downwind. I'm going to say it again. The upwind is when you are going against the wind, and a downwind is when you're going with the wind. The windward is the side of the boat the wind hits first. And the leeward is the side of the boat the wind hits last. And the heading up is moving the boat's bow in the wind. Come on, y'all, I've been studying about the sailor. It is moved towards the direction it is coming from. We are like a sailor. When God blows on us, we have to stir our ship in the right direction. We can't keep going the opposite way, knowing that he's intentional about what he's doing for us in our life. But we keep trying to redirect the ship when the wind is blowing us in the right direction. But we keep going the opposite way. Even the sailor follows the inward, the downward, the leeward, the upward. They follow the wind. And you keep wondering why year after year you are in the same position and your boat's never moving. It's because you're not following the wind. What you think it is? It's the breath of God trying to push you in the right direction. But you keep thinking it's your friends. You keep thinking it's your cousin. You keep thinking it's your job. You keep thinking it's your money. It's the wind of God trying to push you in the right direction. You're not letting go. And letting the captain of your ship blow the Ruha breath of God on you and regenerate you to get you to your rightful place. Somebody say, God, regenerate me. Stop stirring in the wrong direction. Ask him, which direction do you want me to go in this day, this hour, this week, this month, this year, which way, which direction. I need the Ruha breath of God. I need the wind of God to blow me in the right direction. And it is the Spirit that does the quickening in us. It's nothing else. The Spirit of God, the wind of God is what does the quickening in us. When you're messing up, when you're doing things that's wrong, when you're out of the will of God, you have an opportunity to repent. You have an opportunity to ask God to turn me around, to send me back to the place I'm supposed to go. You know my destination. So how do I get there? Well, you only can get there through the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is what directs us. The Holy Spirit is what guides us. So we were learning about the Holy Spirit before the end of the year. So we're going to finish up today. There is 7 ways that the Holy Spirit works through the believer. The wind of God. Because the Holy Spirit is not going to come and sit next to you like your kids and keep tapping on you. Mom, 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 mom. That's not what the Holy Spirit is going to do. The Holy Spirit lives in you. So you have to get a relationship with God so you can know that the Holy Spirit is what's moving you. You have to understand to hear the voice of God. You have to have an understanding. I can teach you all day long, but if you're not in right relationship, if you're not studying the word, if you're not in tune with God, if you're not reading, if you're not praying, if you're not fasting, you're not going to know when the wind of God is coming. And the Holy Spirit does 7 things to us as believers. He regenerates the believers. The Spirit indwells the believers. The Spirit seals the believer. He infills the believer. He empowers the believer for life and service. He guides the believer's life, and he anoints the believer. All this is done through the Holy Spirit. And if you don't study the word, you will never understand why people say, because God said, and things are happening in their life, and you don't know why. It's the wind of God that's moving in their life. And they're not going backwards. They're not turning around. They're moving in the direction that the wind is blowing. Let's go. So, let's start at 1. He regenerates the believer. Now I'm going to break it down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 for those that are taking notes. 1, he regenerates the believer. Let's go to Titus chapter 3, verse 3 to 7. Titus chapter 3, verse 3 to 7. Somebody say, blow on me, God. Blow on me. I want to go in the right direction this year. I don't want to go no other way. I don't want to go with the downwind. Titus chapter 3, verse 3 to 7. It says, at one time, we too were foolish, disobedient, deceived, and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. Stop acting like you so holy that you never did nothing. Stop acting like you so much better than the other woman, a man of God, that you ain't never ever slip, that you ain't never backslid. We all were foolish. We all messed up. Even the ministers, the pastors, the ushers, the singers, the choir members, all y'all acting like, not me, not me. I've been a minister. I've been child of God for so long. I ain't did nothing. You's a lie. And the devil living in you. Come on. I'm happy today. It says, we live in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another. Stop acting like everybody hating on you, because you be hating on people too. Uh-huh. But when the kindness and love of God, our Savior, appeared, when he appeared, he saved us. He ain't take no time. He ain't do a whole lot of questioning. When he appeared, he saved us. When you believe, he saved you. Not because of righteous things we had done, not because of you giving to the home. It's not because you always going out and doing this and doing that and volunteering and, you know, you give all your tithes and offer, you give all your money, you know, you showing up, you so cute, you decent, you got your hair done all the time, and you telling everybody, oh, I'm in the front of the church, I'm doing this, I'm doing that. Nobody cares. Nobody cares. You ain't that righteous. He ain't saved you because you were righteous. He saved you because he loved you. But because of his mercy is why he saved you. It's his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit. That's the regeneration. He regenerates us. And it's a quick work. It don't happen. It don't take a long time. You don't got to do no cartwheels, no split. You don't got to do a whole lot of nothing. It's quick. It's a quick work. When you say, I believe, you are instantly renewed. You are instantly washed. It says, he saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Lord. He poured out on us the Holy Spirit through Jesus Christ our Lord when he died on the cross for our sins. It was the blood. Somebody say it was the blood. So that having been justified by his grace, you were justified. That means all the stuff you've done in your past, it's as if it never happened. Come on, Jesus, wash it all away. That's what David said. Scrub me so I can be guiltless, so I can be justified. David knew what to ask for. He ain't playing no games. He came straight for him. Then it says, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. So he regenerates the believer instantly. But you gotta believe. You have to believe. Let's go on. The Spirit indwells the believer. That's number two. The Holy Spirit indwells the believer. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16. It says, don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in your midst? Do you know that? Do you believe that? Do you believe that when you're in your sin and when you're doing good and when you're doing bad, everything you're doing, he's always with you. He dwells in your midst. He's omnipresent. He's inside of you. He dwells in your midst. If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person. For God's temple is sacred, and you together are that temple. You are sacred. You endow the temple of the Holy. You are the Holy. You endow the Holy Spirit in your temple. You gotta know that God is always with you. You gotta know that. Somebody say, I know that. So when you know that, be conscious of what you say. Be conscious of what you do. Be conscious of how you treat people. Be conscious. Because you are in the image of God. And because he dwells inside of you, people are watching you. And they are being saved because of your walk. They are changing because of you. They are making a difference because of you. So you gotta be mindful that he dwells in your midst. You are housing the temple of the Holy Spirit in your temple. You gotta know that. Somebody say, he's inside of me. Let's go to chapter 6, verse 19. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19. It says, do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit? Somebody say, I've been through that, Sheeta. I've been through that. Oh, you did? So why you keep messing up? Why you keep doing what you've done in 2020? Why you keep doing what you've done in 2005? If you already knew that. It says, who is in you, whom you have received from God. Who is in you? I'm just backing it up with scripture. That's all. That's all I'm doing. I'm just backing it up. Who is in you, whom you have received from God? So you received them when you said, I'm ready. When God pricked your heart, when you were saved, you were housed with the Holy Spirit. Instantly. You are regenerated. You are justified. You are not your own. Oh my gosh. Somebody say, I'm not my own. I'm not my own. You were bought at a price. The price was on the cross. The blood was the price. Somebody said the blood was the price. He was whipped for you. Say, thank you, God. Somebody say, thank you, God. Therefore, honor your bodies because God lives inside of you. So it says, therefore honor God with your bodies. We ain't gonna stay in there long, because we done been there before. No matter how imperfect or weak or immature a Christian is, he still has the indwelling of the Holy Spirit once he believes. No matter how imperfect, no matter how many times you messed up, you have received the Holy Spirit. Let's go to Romans chapter 8, verse 9. And then we're going to move on to the third one. Romans chapter 8, verse 9. It says, you, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but are in the realm of the Spirit. Somebody say, go back one scripture. We're going to go to verse 8. Romans chapter 8, verse 8. Write that down for me, Sheen. Those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. We already knew that though, right? Yeah, we studied that before. I just want to remind you. You, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but are in the realm of the Spirit. You are a spirit. You are living in the realm of the Spirit. If indeed the Spirit of God lives in you, and if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. What? I'm going to read it again. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. The Spirit of God indeed lives inside of you. So if you don't have the Spirit of Christ, you do not belong to Christ. You do not belong to our Savior. You do not belong to the one and only true living God. Let's go on. Number 3, the Spirit seals the believer. This seal stands for two things, ownership and likeness. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13 to 14. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13 and 14. Somebody say, I was sealed with the Holy Spirit. Verse 13, and you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, somebody say, when I believed, when you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit. When you believed, you were marked with the seal, the promised Holy Spirit. You know how when you get your birth certificate and they stamp it, and then when you try to go get a passport, they say, I need your birth certificate with the original seal. Come on, somebody. You have an original seal stamped on you. You are a child of the king. You are heir to the throne. You have an original seal. The promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possessions to the praise of his glory. Somebody say it's a guarantee. It's a guarantee. It's ownership. You have ownership because you have been sealed with the Holy Spirit. Let's go on to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30 to 32. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30 to 32. It says, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness. Oh my God, somebody ain't gonna like me today. Get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. You gotta get rid of the bitterness. You gotta get rid of the anger. You gotta forgive. You gotta get rid of the slander. You got to get rid of the malice out of your heart. You have to. because the Holy Spirit is grieved when you acting like that. If somebody hurt you, if somebody did something to you, if somebody said something and you heard about it, just confront them with love so it can be removed from your heart. Bitterness causes anxiety. Bitterness causes ulcers. Bitterness causes cancer. Bitterness causes so many things in your body. You wonder why you're dealing with heart disease and all these different issues in your system. It's because you're holding on to so much bitterness and anger and resentment from people. And instead of letting them know how you feel, you're holding on to it and you're grieving the Holy Spirit that lives inside of you. You gotta forgive and move on. Both them. Come on. Ain't nobody got time for that. We trying to move into the right direction with the will of God, and you still holding on to what somebody said, did, and done. Forget that. Somebody say, bolt that. I'm moving on. But I got time to keep going back and forth with you, with what you saying about me. I'm going to remove this bitterness because I want the Holy Spirit to, have full reign in my body. I want him to be able to control my life. And he can't control my life with me constantly angry. I can't even find out where I gotta go, my next destination, because I keep going back to what people done to me, what people said. You gotta move on. You're grieving the Holy Spirit. Take some time. Take them to lunch. Sit them down and let them know. I'm telling you, you're messing me up. I can't get to where I gotta go. I'm not waiting to 2023 to get it right. I'm getting it done now. And I ain't waiting till February. We're going to get this stuff done now. Let's go on. Let's go to 2 Timothy chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19. I don't know who that was for. I just snapped out for a minute. Because that wasn't in my notes. But I'm just trying to help somebody out. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19. Nevertheless, God's solid foundation stands firm, sealed with this inscription. The Lord knows those who are his. The Lord know you. The Lord knows who you are. He knows who are his. And everyone who confesses the name of the Lord must turn away from wickedness. Nevertheless, God's solid foundation stands firm, sealed with this inscription that the Lord knows who are his. He know you. When you confess that you love him, he immediately knows you. So somebody say, I don't have to worry because it's working for me. He already know you. He already know. So he working it out. He gonna work it out. After the day, he's working it out. Somebody say he working it out just for me. Let's go to 2 Timothy chapter 4. No. That's it. No, that's not right. Let's go to number 4. The Holy Spirit infills the believer. Now we know that the Holy Spirit indwells in the believer, but we also know that he infills the believer. Let's go to Acts chapter 2, verse 4, and then we're going to go to Acts chapter 4, verse 23 to 31. The Holy Spirit infills the believer. Acts chapter 2, verse 4. Acts chapter 2, verse 4. It says, all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now we know that when the disciples went back to Jerusalem and they were in the upper room, that the Holy Spirit came down on them and he filled them with the Holy Spirit and they all began to speak in other tongues. Let's go to Acts chapter 4, verse 23 to 31. Acts chapter 4, verse 23 to 31. Acts chapter 4, verse 23 to 31. I'm going to read all of this because I just want to read what Peter and John was speaking to the people. It says, chapter 4, verse 23, on their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. When they heard this, They raised their voices together in prayer to God. Sovereign Lord, they said, you made the heavens and the earth and the sea and everything in them. You spoke by the Holy Spirit through the mouth of your servant, our father David. He spoke by who? The murderer. He spoke by who? David. So they're quoting what David, their king, the one that killed Bathsheba's husband, that asked for God to create him a clean heart, to ask God to give him a fresh wind. They're quoting what he said. The king, the guy that asked God for forgiveness, and God used him. I'm saying that because God can use you even after you sin, and you can still be prevalent. I'm getting tongue-tied today. What is going on with me? You can still be used in the kingdom in a mighty way, even when you sin, especially because of the blood. See, David didn't even have the blood back then. He just had God. He knew God. He didn't even have the promise of the blood, but he still believed. So if he didn't even have the blood, how much greater are you that believe? And he then gave you the Holy Spirit inside of us. Come on. So Peter and John is now quoting what David said, their father, King David. It says, why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth rise up and the rulers band together against the Lord and against his anointed one. Verse 27. Indeed, Herod and Pontius Pilate met together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in the city to conspire against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. They did what your power and will had decided beforehand should happen. Verse 29. Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness. Stretch out your hand to heal and perform signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant Jesus. Verse 31, this is where we're at. After they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. Now, and we just read in Acts chapter 2 where they were filled with the Holy Spirit in the upper room. But now this is another infilling of the Holy Spirit. We all receive the Holy Spirit when we are saved. However, it's not just one infilling. We all get an indwelling, but it's consistent infillings. When you pray, when you have different situations, when you're up against different emergencies, when you're going through different things in life, you need to ask God for an infilling of the Holy Spirit, a fresh infilling of the Holy Spirit. You don't just get the one. You get more and more and more and more. Come on. Somebody say, I want a fresh infilling. They prayed to God in the place where they were meeting, it started shaking. It was shaking. And now they had a fresh infilling of the Holy Spirit. I want to read my notes real quick. It says, the filling differs somewhat from the indwelling. We may speak of the baptism of the Spirit as that initial act of the Spirit by which, at the moment of our regeneration, we are baptized by the Spirit into the body of Christ. The Spirit then comes and takes up indwelling within the believer. The filling with the Spirit, however, is not confined to one experience or to any one point of time exclusively. It may be repeated times without number. Oh my God, you can get a fresh one every day if you need it. Somebody say, I don't want the old one. I need a fresh one today. There is one baptism, but many infillings with the Holy Spirit. The experience of the apostles in the Acts bears witness to the fact that they were repeatedly filled with the Spirit. Whenever a new emergency arose, they sought a fresh infilling of the Spirit, showing that the apostles who were filled on the day of Pentecost were again filled a few days after. What? They just got the Spirit just endowed on them a couple days before, and they needed a fresh one again. Somebody say, I don't want the same Spirit from 2021. I want a new one in 2022. I need a fresh infilling just to ask for forgiveness. I need a fresh infilling just to talk to somebody that been hurting me. I need a fresh infilling just to go back and say I'm sorry. I need a fresh infilling to just even go back and talk to somebody that I know don't like me. I need a fresh infilling to go and look at my bills today. I need a fresh infilling to go talk to my boss. I need a fresh infilling to talk to my spouse. I need a fresh infilling. Come on, fill me up again. I don't want the same one. I need another one and another one and another one. Come on. We don't want the same infilling as we got last year. God, fill me up different this year. Hallelujah. There is a difference between possessing the Spirit and being filled with the Spirit. All Christians have the first, but not all have the second. Although you may. Somebody say, although I may. How may you? You have to ask for it. Come on, somebody. It's a three-letter word. A-S-K. You got to ask for a fresh infilling. Hallelujah. Let's go on. Number five. The Holy Spirit empowers the believers for life and service. Let's go to Romans chapter 8, verse 1 and 2. Come on, God, give me a fresh infilling. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Romans chapter 8, verse 1 and 2. The Holy Spirit empowers the believer for life and service. He don't just empower us just to walk around full and fresh to death. He empowers us so that we can complete the service of the Lord, so that we can do what we're supposed to do on earth to fulfill the word. We are kingdom citizens. We have to do work in the kingdom. So he gives you a fresh infilling so that you can do the work of the Lord. I know the work of the Lord get tired sometimes. But when you get tired, ask for a fresh one. Come on. Somebody say, ask for a fresh one. Somebody say, I don't want to get tired yet. Romans chapter 8, verse 1 and 2. Therefore, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. When you are in Christ, you will not be condemned. You will not be judged, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit who gives life, who gives what? Who gives life has set you free from the law of sin and death. For Let me just make it just nice and plain for you. When he gave you the Holy Spirit, you were set free immediately from death. You will now have eternal life. What? Me? The one that keep messing up? Yup, you. The one who keep doing stuff? Yup, you. He gave you the Holy Spirit to empower you, so that even through you messing up, you can repent and keep doing the work. You can repent and keep doing the work. You can repent and keep serving. You can repent and keep volunteering. You can repent and keep clothing the naked. You can repent and keep doing the work of the Lord. There's no condemnation. You will not be judged because of the blood. However, because you have the Holy Spirit inside of you, it gives you all right to keep working. Let's go on. I want to read the whole thing. I got time. I got a little bit of time. Okay, I got time. It says, for what the law, verse 3. She put in the chat, Romans chapter 8, verse 1 to 17. I'm going to read the whole thing. It says, verse 3, for what the law was powerless to do because it was weakened by the flesh, God did by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh to be a sin offering. God was a sin offering. He put all our sins on the cross. So he was a sin offering. You know, they had an animal offering. We know they had a sacrificial offering. We know all the offerings. And so he condemned sin in the flesh. He judged your sin Oh my God. I can't because I got too much to go. Let me go on. In order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us, who do not live according to the flesh, but according to the spirit. Verse 5. Those who live according to the flesh have their minds set on what the flesh desires. But those who live in accordance with the spirit have their minds set on what the spirit desires. Somebody say, I desire what God desires for me. I don't want to do what I want to do in my own flesh. I want to follow the spirit of God. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the spirit is life and peace. The mind governed by the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. We just read this earlier. So those who are in the realm of the flesh cannot please God. You, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but in the realm of the spirit, if indeed the spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the spirit gives life because of righteousness. My God. And if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of his spirit who lives in you. Somebody say, come on, Jesus. Verse 12, therefore, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but it is not to the flesh to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. For those who are led by the spirit of God are the children of God. The spirit you receive does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. We're not living in fear. When we believe in God, we don't live in fear. We live in reverence. We live in reverence of God. That's the fear of God, to live in reverence of him, to revere him, to make sure that you always go before God, knowing that he's always present inside of you. So when you do things, make sure that you know that God is present with you. So you don't have a fear. You're not scared, but you reverence him. Come on. Somebody say, I want to learn how to be right. It goes on to say, rather, the spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him, we cry, Abba, Father. The spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are his heirs. H-E-I-R-S. Heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. What? I can have it all and keep getting more? What? I can have it all and keep getting more? Somebody put that in the chat. I can have it all because I'm an heir to the king and keep getting more. If indeed we share in his sufferings in order that we may also share in his glory. Let's go on. He empowers the believer for life and service through the fruit of the spirit. Let's go to Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23. We almost done. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23. But the fruit of the spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Now, I want to break down these three groups that's in the fruit of the spirit. There are three groups. The first group in the fruit of the spirit is in relation to God. That is, the love, joy, and peace is in relation to God. The second is in relation to our fellow man, long suffering, gentleness, and goodness. And the third is our individual Christian life, our faith, our meekness, and our self-control. They're all fruit of the Spirit. They're all broken down in three different groups. However, the Holy Spirit produces the blessed fruit of the Christian life. He empowers us with the Holy Spirit to live this kind of life, the life of fruit. Somebody say amen. Amen. Let's go on to number six. The Holy Spirit is the guide of the believer's life. I'm going to ask y'all for a little bit of time to go over. After the day, I'm not going to go over no more. I'm going to stick to 8 o'clock. But please, I want to finish this Holy Spirit series so we can go on with the book of Peter so we can continue up with our series. But I got two more to go. The Holy Spirit is the guide of the believer's life. Let's go to Galatians chapter 5, verse 16 to 25. We're going to start at verse 16. Now, the Holy Spirit guides us in the believer's life. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16, we already there. It says, so I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. Walk by the Spirit. How in the world can I walk by the Spirit and getting on my nerves? How can I walk by the Spirit when I'm about to slap somebody? How can I walk by the Spirit when every time I turn around, I'm frustrated? How can I walk by the Spirit and every time I turn around, I'm about to snap? How do we walk by the Spirit, Lord? You cannot gratify the flesh. You got to pray. You got to stop and ask God to infill you with the fresh anointing of the Holy Spirit. Because you're going to need it. Because I'm about to slap the mess out of her. But I need a fresh infilling. And that's how we feel sometimes. How can I walk by the Spirit? All this studying I'm doing, all this praying, all this fasting. But I'm living in this flesh. You got to pray. You got to stop and count to 10 like they used to say. Just count to 10. And it works. But while you count and pray. Somebody say, while I'm counting, I'm going to pray. That's right, Stacey. Holy Spirit, activate. That's right. Activate, Holy Spirit. Verse 17. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit. The flesh don't want you to walk in the Spirit. It's contrary. It wants you to slap her. The flesh wants you to knock them out. It's contrary to the Spirit. And the Spirit, what is contrary to the flesh? They are in conflict with each other so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the flesh are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, that's that smacking her in the face, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. I want to find out what that says in the Message version. I'm gonna find out real quick. Give me 1 second. I want to see what verse 19 says in the Message version. Chapter 5, verse 19 in the Message version. It says, it is obvious what kind of life develops out of trying to get your own way all the time. Oh my God, it's the word. Repetitive, loveless, cheap sex, a stinking accumulation of mental and emotional garbage, frenzied and joyless grabs of happiness. What? That's what it says? It's obvious. They're evident. Let's go on. Verse 21. I warn you, as I did before, those that live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. That don't mean that you will go to hell. It means that you will not receive the will of God that God has for your life. So, be careful to walk in the spirit. There is no detail of the believer's life that may not be under the control and direction of the spirit. That means you can be in step with the Holy Spirit. There's no detail of your life that God cannot control. He has your life in control, but you have to make sure that you're always following the Spirit. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. The Holy Spirit guides the believer as to the field in which he should labor. Let's go on. The Holy Spirit anoints the believer. All right, this is our last one. Let's go to 1 John chapter 2, verse 27. 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2, verse 27. It says, as for you, the anointing you received from him remain in you. I'm going to say it again. As for you, the believer, the anointing you received when you became a Christian, when you believed in the Holy Spirit, when you believed in Jesus Christ, you will always have that anointing. It remains in you, and you do not need anyone to teach you. But as his anointing teaches you about all things, and as that anointing is real, not counterfeit, just as it has taught you, remain in him. The anointing stays with you as long as you remain in him. You have to remain in him. It is for the knowledge and teaching. You need the anointing. You cannot walk around all nilly-willy, acting all regular, and thinking that you're not going to lose the anointing. The anointing, you want the anointing to stay fresh and powerful. You want people to be able to feel the anointing on you. The anointing is used for the knowledge and teaching. I'm going to read my notes. It says, let's go to verse 2, chapter 2, verse 20. Let's go to chapter 2, verse 20 first. 1 John chapter 2, verse 20. It says, but you have an anointing from the Holy One, and all of you know the truth. So we all know that we were anointed from God. You did not just receive the Holy Spirit. You received the Holy Spirit because you believe. So because you have the Holy Spirit from God, you know the truth. So act like you know the truth. When you learn the word, you have to live like you know the word. You have to live like you know the word. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 2, 9 to 14. Because there it teaches us that there are some great truths that are spiritually discerned. They cannot be understood by saving by the spirit-filled man, for they are spiritually discerned. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9 to 14. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9 to 14. The anointing is, you can feel when somebody has the anointing on their life. When they speak, you can feel it. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9 to 14. It says, however, as it is written, what no eye has seen, and what no ear has heard, and what no human mind has conceived, the things God has prepared for those who love him. These are the things God has revealed to us by his Spirit. The Spirit searches all things, even the deep things of God. The Spirit searches all things. So if you're not studying the word and he's searching your heart, he's searching for the word inside of you. For who knows a person's thoughts except their own spirit within them? In the same way, no one knows the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. What we have received is not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, so that we may understand what God has freely given us. This is what we speak, not in words taught us by human wisdom, but in words taught by the Spirit. That lets us know that we don't have to be taught the Word of God. The Holy Spirit teaches us. The Holy Spirit teaches us the Word of life. This word that we read is Spirit. And when we read it, it's life. It brings life. So you don't have to be taught by no one. If you read this word, God will teach you all things. When you need an answer, when you need to understand something, go to the word. You can ask a minister. Yes, you can. You can ask your pastor. Yes, you can. You can ask a seasoned Christian, one that's been in the word a long time. But I'm telling you that when you are anointed, the word of God will give you exactly what you need. He teaches us through the word. Because of the anointing that's on your life, he will give you exactly what you need. Verse 14, the person without the Spirit does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, but considers them foolishness and cannot understand them because they are discerned only through the Spirit. You only can receive the Spirit of the Word because of the anointing that's on your life. It's only discerned through the Spirit. If you don't have the Spirit of God inside of you, you won't be able to receive this word. You're going to think it's foolish. The person with the Spirit makes judgments about all things, but such a person is not subject to merely human judgments. For who has known the mind of the Lord so as to instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. Somebody say, I have the mind of Christ. You were anointed with the mind of Christ. So you have the knowledge and teaching. That's what the Holy Spirit anointed us for, the knowledge and teaching. That's what he gave us. He also anointed us for service. Let's go to Luke chapter 4, verse 18. Luke chapter 4, verse 18. It says, the Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me. The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me. Somebody said, the Spirit of the Lord is on me. You don't have to be a pastor, a minister. You don't have to be an apostle or a prophet. The Spirit of the Lord is on you and he has anointed you to proclaim the good news to the poor. That's what the Bible teaches us. In Matthew, he told us to go out into the world, teaching disciples, teaching people and make disciples to the ends of the earth. He anoints you to do that. And he will give you the knowledge and the teaching. I don't have a doctorate in divinity. I went to Manna Bible Institute. I went to a certificate program. The Lord has anointed me to study the word, to dissect it, to teach it to you. I have not been to school a long time. I went to school for 5 years. But people will be going to school for year after year after year after year. Do you know the pastors back in the day didn't even go to college? They didn't get a degree in divinity. They was teachers. They were pastors. And guess what? Those pastors that didn't even go to school had a true heart for God. They took care of the saints. They called the saints when they was not there. They called the saints when they were not present at church. They took care of the saints when they were weak, when they were dealing with things, when they had issues. They would take care of the saints. The pastors back then, they didn't even have a study guide. They went by the word of God, by the anointing that was on their life. God anointed them to preach the word. So they went by being a shepherd, because a shepherd takes care of their sheep. It's a difference. You can go to school and learn all day long how to teach the word and to dissect it in the theology and the hermeneutics. You can learn all of that. But if you don't have the true heart of God to take care of the sheep, to find out are they okay, to take care of their life, to make sure they're fine, to make sure that you're giving back to the those that are naked and those that are hungry. It don't mean nothing. I don't care how many degrees you have in divinity. I don't care what school you went through. I don't care what you have done to get your degree in theology and ministry. It don't mean nothing if you don't have the heart of God. You have to have the anointing on your life. That's what it meant in the scripture we just read. The anointing will teach you. You don't need a degree. It's the anointing. Jesus stood in the synagogue and read. It says, the Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to proclaim the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight to the blind, to set the oppressed free, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. That's my job. My job and my mandate as a minister of the gospel, Reverend Lee's job is to preach to the poor, to proclaim freedom to the prisoners, the recovery of sight to the blind, not natural blindness, but those that just can't see how good God is. They can't see the wind of God in their life. That's my job. To teach, that's our job as believers in Christ, to teach the word, to proclaim the good news. That's our job. And that's why he anointed you. He anointed you for service. He didn't anoint you just to be cute. He didn't anoint you just to get up and say, I'm a believer. I love the Lord. Walking around with your Bible in your hand. He didn't anoint you for that. He anointed you to help somebody. He anointed you to lay hands on somebody. He anointed you to pray with somebody. He anointed you to help save somebody. Because it's through the Holy Spirit that the work happens. It ain't you that's doing it. It's the Holy Spirit that's doing it. But he needs you. He needs a body. He needs a vessel. And the only way he can get the vessel is, only way the work can get done is through the vessel. That's what the anointing is for. So I don't care how many degrees you got. I don't care what your paper say. That paper don't mean nothing to me if I'm not doing the work of God. If I'm not finding out how my sheep is doing. If I'm not making sure that they okay. It don't mean a thing. Let's go on. The anointing also was for consecration. There were three classes of people in the Old Testament who were anointed. It was the prophet, the priest, and the king. They were the only people that were anointed. However, when Jesus Christ died on the cross, and he then endowed the disciples with the Holy Spirit, and now we are able to receive the Holy Spirit, we are now all able to receive the anointing for consecration. That's why they have consecration services. Because you have to be anointed for service. Stop just trying to do stuff. Ministry and doing the will of God is not just something to do. You are supposed to be anointed for service. You are to consecrate yourself. Consecrate your body. You know, when they did consecration in the Word in the Old Testament, they would wash themselves. They would not have sex with their loved ones. They would not do anything. They would not sin. They would try to stay away from sin as much as possible to consecrate themselves for the Lord. They would fast. They would put on sackcloths. They would put on ashes so that they can separate themselves from sin so that God can anoint them for service. These were just the priests, the prophets, and the kings. But now we are able to be consecrated. Oh my God. We are able to be consecrated so that we can go forward. Somebody say, Lord, consecrate me. So, I want to read what this says. Thy bowels are upon me. I want to go to the scripture real quick. One second. Thy bowels are upon me. In the Bible, Psalm chapter 56, verse 12. Let's go to Psalm chapter 56, verse 12. And then we are complete. Psalm chapter 56. Verse 12. Psalm chapter 56 verse 12 says, I am under vows to you, my God. I will present my thank offerings to you. I am under vows to you. When you consecrate yourself for the Lord and you are anointed for service, you have given a vow. You have given a vow. Like when you get married, if you give your vows, you give a vow to God. And when you give a vow to God, you are saying that you are going to stick to it. You are not going to stop. You are going to stay focused. I'm not going to go left and right. I'm not going to be swayed back and forth. I'm not going to be thrown by to and fro by the wind. I'm not going to go here and there. I'm going to do what God says, and I'm going to take this vow seriously. You are under a vow when you consecrate yourself for service. So I'm saying to you on this day, this second Sunday of January, you need to ask God to anoint you for service, to consecrate you, to take a couple days to separate yourself from sins, from things that is not godly, to be able to remove yourself from the things that is separating you from getting in the face of God, so that you can receive all of the anointing that God has for you, so you can have the knowledge and understanding for what you need to do in the earth realm. Not what you're supposed to do on your job. Not what you're supposed to do as a mother or a father. Not what you're supposed to do with your friends and your cousins and your family. But what you're supposed to do for the Lord. You need to be consecrated and anointed for the service of 2022. The Holy Spirit already is living inside of you. But you need to be consecrated so that God can get the glory out of your life. You don't want to just be in this life constantly going to and fro, tossed to and fro by the wind. You want to be able to be sure of your destination. You want to know what you got to do. My assignment is to be on this live every single Sunday to make sure that I encourage you to stay focused in the Lord. That's my mandate. Do I want to get up every day? Some Sundays I'm like, oh my gosh, it's Sunday again. I got to get up. But guess what? I ask for a fresh infilling of the Holy Spirit so I can do my mandate that I was called to do. I'm not going to be tossed to and fro by every wind. You got to know your assignment and stick to your assignment and be anointed in that area. I am anointed to teach you on Sunday mornings. I'm anointed to be able to serve. I am anointed to do that. I'm not going to go outside of what God has gave me. But you have a different assignment. Ask God, what is your assignment on this earth? So that you can receive all that God has for you. And God can get the glory out of your life. Don't just keep walking around willy-nilly. I don't know what God has for me. I don't know my purpose on earth. How many years are you going to say that? You got to know what your purpose is. And he didn't infill you with the Holy Spirit to keep using that same excuse. You got to get busy in the kingdom. It's time to get busy for the Lord. If you got one assignment to mentor one child, then that's your assignment. If you got one assignment to help the homeless, then do that. If you got one assignment to just clothe the naked, then do that. If you got one assignment to give all the time, every time you see somebody that's dealing with different issues and you are very good in encouraging, then encourage. Whatever it is, don't let this anointing be deflated because you want to just keep saying, I don't know my purpose. You got to get busy for the kingdom. The spirit that lives inside of us is stirred up every single day. And we don't got that much time left on this earth. People are dying by the minute. They are dying by the boatload. And you don't want to be caught slipping. You don't want to be caught being lazy. You don't want to be caught not doing what you're supposed to do in this earth. You want your life to be spoken well of. You don't want your good to be evil spoken of. You want everything that you do on this earth to be said that at least she tried. At least she did what God called her to do. So I'm going to tell you, first thing you got to do is get rid of that malice out of your heart. You got to get rid of that bitterness because the Holy Spirit, you're really grieving the Holy Spirit. And then you got to ask God to give me a fresh infilling, God. I need to feel you. I need to know you're there. I want to feel you. I want to know that you're sitting in the boat with me. I'm at zero fish. I want to be able to throw my net on the other side and come up with so many fish that I can't even lift it. I want to be a net breaker. That my net is so heavy that it's about to break with fish. I want a regeneration of the Holy Spirit inside of me. I want you to regenerate me. Revive me. Reawake me. You gotta ask God for that. It's time out for games. It's time out to keep playing. You gotta know. You have to know that you're not here as a happenstance. You have a purpose in this life. And your purpose is waiting for you to come and sign up. So you gotta do what God says. I'm excited because we are now done with Holy Spirit. I hope you receive something out of this Holy Spirit series. I went from 1 Peter. I went from one scripture. I'm going to go to this one scripture. We was at 1 Peter chapter 1. We were at verse 12. And I stopped at verse 12. And I have not left that verse yet because I've been talking about the Holy Spirit ever since. But I needed you to understand how powerful the Holy Spirit is in our lives. And we need an infilling every day. If you need a fresh infilling every day, ask for it. If you're getting tired, if you've been in this walk a long time, and you've been doing this thing called Christianity a long time, I know you're tired. I know you're frustrated. I know it gets weary. I know you've been doing this thing for a long time. But don't give up. This is not the season to give up. This is not the time to throw in the towel. It's time to just get a fresh one. Somebody say, I need a fresh one. Come on. The Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 12, it was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves, but you. When they spoke of the things that now have been told you by those who have preached the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, even angels long to look into these things. So next Sunday, we will be starting in verse 13, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13. We'll be starting there. We'll be talking about how to be holy. So I'm just so excited for all of you. If you did the fast, and if you did not do the fast, first of all, if you did the fast, praise God for you. Because when you fast, you're fasting for yourself. Fasting is not for God. Fasting is for you. It's for you to get closer to God. And if you have fasted, in that fast, I hope that you ask God to give you the insight and understanding. If you did not fast, I'm asking you to take one day in January. We ain't got that many days left. But take one day in January to just fast. Just all water. Give God just one day so that you can hear him speak to you about what you are supposed to do in the earth. Then I need you to text me and say, Sheeta, I'm ready. That's all. I don't even want to know what he asked you to do. Just say, Sheeta, I'm ready. Because I can't do it alone. She can't do it alone. He can't do it alone. We need everyone to be moving. We need everyone to be doing their part. We need everyone to be active in this kingdom. Everyone needs to be active in the kingdom. And you are so anointed to do it that I'm encouraged that so many people will be texting me saying, I'm good, Sheeta, I'm ready. So if you don't know Jesus Christ, the pardon of your sins, and you're on this live and you want to get to know him, you will instantly be filled with the Holy Spirit. That's an immediate. You will be sealed with the Holy Spirit. If you don't know him today, and if you do know him, and you say, Rashida, you know what? I know him, but I've been far away from him. I've been doing me. I've been doing what I want to do. It's time for a fresh infilling. You don't got to get resaved, but you can rededicate your life today. You can rededicate your life and start all over again. I'm just so excited because God has blessed us to be able to just speak a word of confession. Speak a word that you love the Lord and you will be immediately saved, all because of the blood. It don't take nothing but you just confessing with your mouth and believing in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord, and you will be saved immediately. You will receive the Holy Spirit and you will be justified, and everything that you have done in this earth will be as if you never done it before, and you can start all over brand new, washed. And when people see you, they will see Christ. You will be clothed with his image. Oh my God, I love it. Because you will no longer be your own. So, if you don't know Jesus Christ, the pardon of your sin, just repeat after me. Lord Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God. And I believe you came to earth. And I believe you died on the cross for me. And I believe you shed your blood for me. And I believe you rose from the dead. Right now, I come to you, Lord Jesus, because I am a sinner. Forgive my sins. Cleanse me with your blood. Make me clean. And I will be clean. Come into my heart. Save my soul. I no longer belong to Satan. I belong to you. I am forever yours. And I am now saved. Amen. Most gracious eternal Father, we bless your holy and righteous name. Father, we thank you so much for this teaching today, God. Father, we thank you so much for your Ruha breath of God. Father, we thank you so much for Numa, the Spirit of God. We thank you so much for the wind, the fresh wind, God. We thank you that David was not afraid to ask for you to create in him a clean heart and renew him a right spirit. God, we ask you to send us a fresh wind today like never before. God, help us to go in the right direction. Help us to not be continued to go to and fro, being tossed by every wind. Father, we ask you today to continue to cover us and keep us. Continue to seal us with your spirit, God. Give us a fresh infilling of the Holy Spirit. Let us not like be like we was yesterday. Not like how we was last month. But we want people to see us how we are today, brand new with your anointing, God. We love you. We honor you. We thank you. Now today, we ask you to continue to cover us and keep us. Saturate us with your love. Father, we thank you. We love you. We honor you. Now may the grace of God and the love of Jesus Christ and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, abide, henceforth, and forevermore. May the children of the living God say amen, amen, and amen. I love y'all. Thank y'all so much for hanging out with me today. I am so glad that we finished this Holy Spirit series. Oh my God, Miss Theta. We did it, we did it, we did it. We went to the end. So, I just want to say, continue to stay focused. Continue to be consistent. Be like Esther. Esther said, if I die, let me die. But I'm going to do what God said. If I perish, let me perish. If I perish, let me perish like that, Esther. Well, we're going to be like Esther. If I die, let me die. But I'm going forth. I love y'all. God bless y'all. And I say, the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. And may the Lord shine his face upon you and be gracious to you. And the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. I love y'all. You get up out of your bed. If you're in your bed, get dressed. Go to church. Get on Zoom. If you have not yet, turn on somebody. Listen to somebody if you ain't get enough today. But I'm telling you, go to the house of the Lord. And if you're not saved, I hope you got saved today. I had so many different things that I had set up for SGS to be in a ballroom, but I am unable to do it. But I'm going to set it up so we can be on Zoom. So look out for me sending out some information so we can be on Zoom together, so we can meet each other, so we can see each other's faces, so that those that have joined SGS Ministry and those that not joined SGS Ministry, who have joined the family of Christ, forgive me, Lord, that have joined the family of Christ. We want to give you the right hand of fellowship. We want to let you know that you are a part of this kingdom. And we want you to know that we are your sister in Christ. We are your sisters and brothers in Christ. So we're going to do that really soon. So look out for my text. If you don't have, if you're not connected with SGS, I need you to text SGS to the number 474747. And if you are not on Facebook all the time, go to my YouTube page. I'm on there every single Sunday to Reverend Rashida Lee, R-E-V-R-A-S-H-E-E-D-A-H-L-E-E. And please, somebody, share this live. Let somebody know the Holy Spirit lives inside them and they are anointed. Come on, y'all. I bless y'all. God bless y'all. And thank y'all so much for fasting with me. Y'all are amazing. Guess what? You amazing. You are amazing. You decent. I love y'all. God bless you. There go the number. Text sports SGS to 474747. Love y'all.